here with Roger Hinton, who was Honorary Secretary of the Regency Society. Welcome to the vote, Roger.
Thank you.
Should we just start off by talking about the Regency Society, its background and the role it's had in the city for a number of years now?
Yeah, sure. The first thing I always say when I'm talking about the Regency Society is that the name is misleading, but we're stuck with it, so perhaps I could just explain that. It was founded in 1945, at the end of the Second World War, and it was founded on the back of a big campaign to save the Regency architecture on Brighton seafront, particularly Brunswick Square, Brunswick Terraces. There was a plan to knock all that down and build blocks of flats.
Well, you just can't imagine that.
Well, we can't now, but at that time, that was being proposed.
Yeah.
And from there, it has grown. But I think that the other important thing to emphasise is that we're not just interested in the history of the city. We are interested in that. But we're also interested in the future of the city. And so we spend a lot of time looking at development proposals for new buildings and any other schemes like Valley Gardens and so on, any big proposals for the city, yeah. We will look at and perhaps express an opinion on.
Yeah, and what are the key? You've got some jewels in the crown, haven't you, in terms of some of the architecture which you kind of represent. So you said Brunswick Square, but we've got Sussex Square. We've got Lewis Crescent.
I'll declare an interest. I live in Regency Square.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, Regency Square, in spite of its name, is not really the jewel in the crown because, as you probably know, it was developed as a car park.
Yeah.
And it now has a car park underneath it, which means the gardens are not exactly as they should be.
Yes.
If you go along to the west, you come to Brunswick Square. Now, that has been protected far better.
Yes.
And I would say that there are two jewels in the crown, and Brunswick Square is one of them. And there the gardens are much as they would always have been.
Yes.
And if we go up to the other end of the city, in Kemp Town, you have Lewis Crescent and Sussex Square. And that, I think, is the other jewel in the crown in terms of seafront architecture. And let's add another one, so in case anybody thinks I've forgotten it, and that's the Royal Pavilion, of course, which is the crown, really.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
But there's a number. We've got a lot of Grade 1 and Grade 2 listed buildings in Brighton. Are we overrepresented on, you know, in terms of the average amount of listed buildings in Brighton?
Because I don't think we're overrepresented. Right. No, I think that a lot these buildings are listed over time, and people come to the conclusion that they need to be protected.
Yes.
And no, I think.
Is there anything currently that should be protected, you think, that currently isn't in the city?
At the moment, our concerns are not to do with particular buildings that need protecting. I mean, who knows? Tomorrow there might be a proposal to demolish something important. But at the moment, our concerns are with big new development proposals which are underway.
Yes.
For example, at Brighton Marina, there's a proposal for a housing development at the west end of Brighton Marina, which will actually be built on a platform out over the water.
Yes, yeah.
And that's going to provide 1,000 new apartments if it goes ahead. The city plan, which is what the planners look at when they want to know what should happen, the city plan says that that's a good location for housing, and the city plan says we need a lot more housing, 13,000 new homes over the next few years.
Thanks for coming in, Roger, and all the best with the society, and we'll catch up again soon. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.